shit acting like a munchkin.
Talk to Bill, he's gotta get some better wheels on these babies.
Okay. Paul, move down.
You need a contribution.
I'm sure.
And then I'll just move this a little bit. Okay, you wanna introduce everybody, right? Okay. 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 We're ready.
Well, welcome. It's Wednesday, August the 9th, 2023, and again, it's the weekly Wednesday Virginia Liberty broadcast. I've been going to last for 6 weeks. I had to dig into my brain there to make sure I could remember what we're doing here today, so forgive me for a moment. I'm really a pleasure. You know, we have, just to give you a little bit to remind you of how we work things here, as we talk about our issue today, you can put your issues, because we're broadcasting on VB Liberty on Facebook, as well as people, you know, you can share it on your personal Facebook as well, but you can put your questions and type them in the comment section, and our big producer here, Robert Dean, will let us know about halfway through the show. We'll turn to those questions, and we'll let our guest here today answer those. I'm really pleased today. This is a momentous thing because the issue that we're talking about today, which is the Whycliff rezoning of the releasing, I shouldn't say rezoning, releasing a conditional use permit on a church property in a neighborhood, was before the Planning Commission today. And we always like to think that everybody can win. So I know in the long run, the community will be looking to figure out how to help the church be successful so that can work. So there's a win-win situation here. But the good news is the Planning Commission on stage one of the process did not grant the request. I like to say that person's denied. Did not grant the request of the property owner to release them from their religious conditional use permit, which would have permitted their sale and the building ultimately possibly of up to 12 homes and the loss of a natural water, stormwater retention, not only holding system, but also I would call a water filtration system and a wildlife habitat and a community asset as well. So tonight I have with me from that community, Wendy Crutchfield, she's here, she's to my immediate left. Andrew Boyles is next to her. And then Chris Savides is on my right. And they're gonna be the ones today to tell us a little bit about how they organize, because I know infill development is a challenge we're facing across the communities of Virginia Beach. It's not unique. We've seen several of them not be as successful as you have been. And so I think people will be out there interested in not only what the issues were, how you organized, how you did your homework, your outreach, and also what's next, not only as you go to city council, but what's next as you work with the church itself or other long-term solutions to the economic situations they face on the property. Over to you, Wendy.
Okay. So I just go through a little bit of the history of how we got here. So if we backtrack and when Virginia Beach was, before Virginia Beach was developed, this lake system was part of the Lynn Haven River. And so naturally, the water flows from the higher level down to the lower level, and so it flowed down Lynn Haven River and out to Chesapeake Bay. So back when farms started to get developed here, they created a few dams, and those dams were to provide water use for the residents and for agricultural purposes. So this lake in question was a dammed off part of the Great Neck Lake system. Also known as Lake Conrad II. So there's Lake Conrad 1, 2, and 3, and they're all part of the Great Neck Lake system. So the property, this was natural stormwater drainage. The property behind it was later, in the 1950s, was developed in the Great Neck Estates. So the properties had been zoned R10, and R20, back of the neighborhood is R20, and there was no reason to subdivide the property any further. It wasn't being developed. That parcel was owned by a Pepsi Cola executive at the time, and he used the hunting lodge that was there for having executives come, and they fished from there, enjoyed the wildlife. maybe probably bird hunted some from there. Great Neck Estates was developed, and Great Neck Manor across the street. So then the church bought the property, and they requested a conditional use permit. This use permit is what came up to question today at Planning Commission, because now they want to sell off part of their unused property, and they want to remove that conditional use permit. So back in 1966, when they asked for the use permit to be put there, it went to the city planners, and they asked for that, and the neighborhood and all the citizens, and the government said that's a good thing. Having a church use is a benefit. Well, now they want to abandon that, but its sole purpose is to now make a housing development. That housing development, who they have already received their joint permits through the Army Corps of Engineers and the DEQ, you know, and all the regulatory agencies, they've already made it through those hurdles. So this is the one, today was the one and only chance that we had to have a, you know, public forum in front of the Planning Commission. And then the next one is before the City Council. Because essentially, the builder already plans to fill in the lake, he was already getting the approvals all across the board, and the Planning Commission heard the request, and they were really unsettled by it. They knew that what I just said was true, that he was, that the next step, he would go through the planning and had already had all the approvals and the lake would be filled in. And they said, we're not comfortable with this. At least the majority said they weren't comfortable with it.
Well, just to clarify so people know that when someone says R10, that means 10,000 square foot lots, which is still a big lot. Most lots in the city were like 7,500. So then, and R20 is like 20,000 square foot. So that's a sizable lot in the city even today. Would be a large lot, just so people know. Now, what was your engagement with the church? Did the church, were you made aware of the church that they were having this deal up front? How did that whole discussion go? Because generally speaking, churches are very sensitive to community concerns, but they have their own issues as well. I'd be interested to, how did that relationship work out, and how's that going to look going forward?
I kind of like to start with the church has been harmed by the stormwater drainage facility that's there, and I'm saying that because they have actually, at one time they received a letter from Virginia Beach that said that they were going to get fined $32,000 if they didn't clear the area around this pond that was a part of the stormwater drainage system well before they even owned the property. And subsequent to that, now they have to take trees down, and they're required to, you know, do some maintenance to something that 36 acres of Great Neck development is draining into. So after some time, the church started to decide that this is too much. It's not an asset for us anymore. It has been an asset all this time for Virginia Beach because it's part of the stormwater drainage system. The city then, they already had an easement that went through. They dredged part of it. They removed a bunch of trees, so they have been investing in it over the years. Did I answer that?
Well, I'm trying to get, because obviously you highlighted is what motivated the church to have a relatively passive piece of property to feel compelled to sell. I go to a church that has a 5-acre parcel in Little Neck. We expanded our parking lot a little bit and ended up having to do a lot of dry retention basin, which was a really added expense. But in your case, you're saying that the water, the pond, or the, it's probably more of a pond than a lake, but a pond that's closed off estuary, which there are many of in Virginia Beach and the Lynn Haven area, was there with the property when they acquired it.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm interested in is the community support for the church to say, well, in fact, this is a drainage thing that's serving the whole community, then why is the maintenance that's benefiting everybody being borne exclusively? I'm not saying there isn't some contributory share by the owner, but being borne exclusively by the property owner. I'm sure they want the trees removed for bank stabilization, which we see on Lynn Haven Mall, if you've noticed, all those trees they took down. Well, they probably noticed that. I'm sure that's for bank stabilization, which reduces sedimentation, which reduces suspended solid, which will be enforced to be considered bay acts. I'm sure all this stuff has some. So I think what we really gotta look at is, yes, the community's winning, but we gotta figure out how the city and the community can help the church win too. Because I think, I just, like, just heard it saying, hey, they're being asked to subsidize, so to speak, a larger benefit. And they can't financially bear the expense. That's what I heard you say.
That's,
I got that right?
That is exactly right. So then they had a private sale arranged. So they came to, it was about a year and a half ago, they came to the neighborhood and said, look, we're selling our property, this is what he's going to do. And so that's how we came to be, to take notice of it.
Well, the good news, that's what I was looking for, is they were very upfront, so you really knew, you weren't surprised, you had time to think about and research and do your homework.
The thing that we were disappointed in is that we felt that there were other options. In fact, it's the perfect property for the city's open space program. It hits all the criteria, and we hope that maybe they could have come to the city and asked for that, or come to find out if there was anybody in the neighborhood who might have had an interest in preserving the property. So, you know, but, and you can't do should-haves.
But fairness to the city, once a property owner has engaged in some conversations with someone for a private sale, you can imagine why you wouldn't want the government then entering into doing something to undermine you. So, you know, because we don't interfere in the actions of others, because maybe before that. That's just a slippery slope. I just want people to realize the city doesn't go out and try to actively undermine discussions, because at that point, the options. We have acquired property. They bought all the land on the left hand side, so there wouldn't be all those homes there, but that's just a wooded easement. So there certainly is precedent has been set, but I do think now that the challenge, hopefully, is you're successful with the decisions being made on a land use basis, like it's careful how you make decisions on city council, that we can look for now what is the long range solution that is a win for the community, a win for stormwater, a win for the church as well. That's what I was trying to. Can you talk a little bit about how you used Facebook? And I think that was, you were very creative. I saw you out there all the time.
I don't like to be on the spotlight at all, but this is very important to the neighbors, the neighborhood, and this is precious ground for a lot of people in a lot of different communities. The special needs community has benefited by this property through the Helping Hands Day Camp that used to operate there, the Infant STEM program, eventually the Early Intervention Center, and then the neighborhood. There have been countless kids who have used that to cross in between the neighborhoods, to go to the arcade, or now to go to the Lynn Haven Dive Center. People go there for walking their dogs. So people love it. They just didn't know what was happening. We didn't have a well-organized civic league at the time, so that was kind of reestablished. And then just trying to pump the information out in several different avenues. So that's what we did. And then we talked in February to our city councilmen, Chris and I, and the Civic League board, and our councilman, Chris Taylor. And he said, do you have a petition? Not a lot of times people have petitions. So we got a petition together last week, and we went from there. So people have been sharing. People really have related. They want nature protected. They want stormwater protected. We're obviously investing in it in our tax dollars. And they want green space. They don't want to see everything developed in regeneration. They want to hold on to what's precious about our history.
Well, Andrew, did you speak at the planning commission meeting today?
I did, and I stayed away from the stormwater subject because I don't know much about it, even though I'm in the building business. But to answer your question, how did we organize? Well, it was Facebook is how we organized, and I know Wendy anyway, and I saw her post about that, and my family lived in Great Neck Estates for about 25 years, from the day they retired till they died. And I still have the house, and I'm considering, because it's one story, living in it in my older years, which are approaching me right now. So anyway, I did have a connection to Great Neck Estates, and being that I have a 45-year building background as a Class A contractor, I thought it was important for me to speak about the fact that you're producing lots that are basically mud pits because they're all filled, and that just doesn't work well in the Jimmy Boots. And I've got a long, long history of telling homeowners that it's going to cost you multi-thousands of dollars to fix your house. Lynn Haven Colony, Bay Island, several places in Great Neck, that the soils weren't looked at like they are today, but, you know, it's still not the best place to build. I don't think anybody in the planning commission wants a house built on fill. So that was my main reason for being there. And I hope I conveyed something to them. Unfortunately, that 3-minute clock ticks quick there, and I didn't get to say everything I needed to say, but I think I hit the best points.
Well, you know, having sat there for 11 years on the other side and listening to all the 3 minutes, I think that when you get a number of people speaking, the puzzle does fit in, that all the 3 minutes do paint the picture. And if you let everyone build the whole puzzle, we'd have to camp out there. Mm-hmm. So I appreciate why there is a time constraint, but it is important that people don't come out. And did Chris, did you speak?
Yes, I did. And I did talk mainly, I just felt that this was being rushed, and I felt that the decision that was being made, considered, was very focused by the Planning Commission relative just to the release of the religious use aspect. But I felt there were so many unanswered questions, and what was tied to that was a direct application of this construction, but that was being removed from really the decision-making process. And I just felt that there was so much more that had to be considered. The implications on the wetlands and stormwater management was just something that was in the application was not even mentioned, and I just felt that it had to be. And this is such a significant aspect for us, and that the head of the neighborhood and just all on Great Neck Road manage that, and that's why I spoke to.
In the Planning Commission's defense, you know, they really have to make sure when they make their decisions, it's legally defensible. And so therefore, they're dealing with the issue of releasing the conditional use permit for religious, that's the land use question, because the issue about stormwater only becomes relevant once you've got to the point of saying you're releasing the use. And then all these other rules come into play, which is why the Planning Commission was very mindful that once the land use decision is made, because of all these permits, and he can meet the statutory quantity and quality, he's going to be able to fill that pond. And the city isn't going to have a legally, rightfully so, defensible point, because the property rights, unfettered property right, has been restored. Mm-hmm. So the Planning Commission, to their credit, and to defend the decision they made, had to focus on what they were asking for, which was releasing the conditional use permit, and whether or not they had made a compelling case to be, because they got a benefit from that, right? They got a benefit from that. They didn't pay taxes on that property a lot of times. So I know it from the looks of like there's lots to consider, but just trying to be from the other side,
right?
They want to make sure that what they decide, the city attorney can legally defend. Well,
I agree with that. In fact, there was another application on the docket today that was the removal of a religious criteria, and at the same time changing it to a commercial, and then there was going to be a development there. And there, everything was included, the impact statement, all this kind of stuff that we were trying to bring. And it just seems like if you're going to remove that criteria, I realize it's very focused. I even said that when I was talking. But in other applications, it opened the door to all this other scrutiny. Why wasn't that door open to scrutiny on this one? And I understand I had someone tell me, you know, why, but it just seems to, if you're going to have this development afterwards, that should be considered in the decision-making process.
I don't know what goes on in the minds of the Planning Commission members before they vote. That's their own, you know, mental activity. But I do know when you're bypassing, when you go to express and make the motion for whatever you're doing, the reasoning that you give for the decision has to comport with what the Planning Commission's jurisdiction is. So
yeah.
I think often, even before council, lots of extraneous stuff is put in there. I don't know how that influences how people vote. When it comes time to explain the vote for the record, the explanation has to match the scope of what is before you. I do believe these other things influence how people vote,
mm-hmm.
but they don't read people's minds when you get sued for making a bad decision or thinking maybe one mm-hmm. should have made. But I do think the Planning Commission members knew that once they removed that, there wasn't any city discretion relative to their ability to fill the pond.
Mm-hmm.
Because all they have to do is meet the stormwater
yeah.
discharge requirements. And so that's maybe not quite the same as a commercial center.
Right, and I realize the difference. But and the thing, too, that I spoke against and I was concerned about is that this was a city asset to handle stormwater, and there's going to be no real consideration. And just because there's some sort of arbitrary determination on the size that was under the threshold that didn't require the scrutiny, it was still a very, very important part of the stormwater in this area, and I didn't feel like it was a big
deal. Well, maybe a lesson learned,
yeah.
or something to take back to Chris. I know Chris Councilman Taylor is a very good listener, does a great job representing his district. Is maybe that shows a regulatory shortcoming, and maybe that needs to be changed, because that's a good lesson learned. That hey, wait a minute, this size isn't the determinant of the impact, and so maybe that needs to. So that's something I think that's a lesson learned for the community. Hey, you know, size isn't the only factor. These other things need to be considered as to when, or maybe in light of stormwater today, maybe there isn't anything too small to really be evaluated because of the difference it can make in terms of whether your home floods or not, or the quality of water that goes in the Lynn Haven. So I would think the Lynn Haven now people would be, I think I look for partnerships from the lessons that we learned, because that's how things get fixed.
I think that if there was a whole lot of conditional use permits that are going to be reverted back to original zonings, then there probably should be some oversight of having site plans conditioned with those changes. Because this was a prime example. You had a religious use and it was being to R10, but there wasn't a site plan. There wasn't a site plan presented by the applicant. I had it with me and showed it, and I'm sure most of these planning commissioners knew that, but you know, it wasn't a good site plan for anybody, really.
Well, here's the challenge that we face, or the council faces. I'm trying to make sure that people that aren't here get their view kind of out there from my experience, is that the building community says that, hey, we do these site plans, right? We spend a lot of money developing these detailed site plans, but in the end, they're often not the site plan that actually gets approved for final construction. He says, so we spend a lot of money, but then it's not the thing that we actually use, and we spend the money again. So why don't we focus on the issues, knowing that the site plan that actually is approved is going to comport to all the requirements, which makes, you know, duplication makes sense. So now you focus on the real issue, knowing that they're going to solve stormwater, right? That's going to be solved. So I really have to see that they plan to use underground bladders, but in the end they did something else. Well, you didn't do the way you say, so we don't want to hold them to that. So why go through all that expense? So that was the side. So site plan isn't the real issue, because the real issue here was the city foregoed building houses to start with, right? And all the revenue they would have gained to give the community a church. The church and getting their church then also had this additional property that provides an asset to the community. So now you have a community equity and a city equity and a property. You go forward 40 years, life changes, But why does that change the contractual obligation of the owner, be it a 7-Eleven or a church or whoever it was, to utilize it? I'm not gonna profit from that, but all the other equity owners don't get a say. And that was really, I think, the big thing here, is it wasn't just the owner of the church that had equity in the decision. It was the city as an entity, and then the community as residents that had an equity in the decision, and they're not wanting to have that released, and they relied upon the city's commitment when they built their homes and did their stuff. So it's kind of a unique arrangement. It's not the only one that's like that, but it does get to your point, is as infill gets, we need to rethink about who's all involved in the conditional uses, because what was the reason for the conditional use? And who are the equity owners in that condition? It's not just the owner of the property. And how are their equity interests protected? I think the Planning Commission did a good job of recognizing that. And then you all did a good job of communicating that. That isn't always going to be the case. That isn't always the case with all conditional use permits. But it certainly was here. It wasn't the case, when we had Boyle Farms or Hawthorne Church. There was a case where the property didn't have any conditions. The church sold their property, thinking it would be one thing, but it wasn't inviting, so they got a gas station. So, seller beware. But nonetheless, any insights that you would share with other people, Wendy, as from your experience? We'll give it around to you. Just that thing turns pretty well. We can strike it there so we can get close.
Get real close.
Okay. So all of our power is with each other, when we work together and we're not divided. And the community, they all have this mutual care for this subject for a variety of different reasons. And my advice would be, to share with others, to get together with others and share any concerns that you have and figure out a way to, to correct them.
Now, is there a plan of this group now that, of course, now you got another decision going forward to City Council, assuming that follows the recommendation of the Planning Commission, about now the next step of how to get the church, the city, and the community to find, working with police, of course, and the city staff, to find the financial solution, which really is the core of what's caused this thing to float up, is this financial issue that the church faces and whose obligation is who. I'm not saying how that should be solved here, but it sounds to me like that if that isn't the ultimate, someone might say, the church might not ultimately be viable, and the church property itself sold, and someone wants to build houses just on the church property. Maybe that's acceptable to the community, I don't know. But ultimately, there's a challenge here that just didn't go away because of today.
Well, I don't really know the dynamics of the financial hardships this church has, so if they would, and I wasn't at the first meeting with the church, but if they laid out their cards, what they needed, it would give us more of a negotiating arena that we could talk with the developer and the church and say, well, what kind of money do you need? Because, and I say that only because there was only one option presented today. That was 12 lots. That's the site plan that was leaked or given to us. It wasn't presented as documentation for this application, but they need to consider all the players in this. And if they need to have parcel 5 lots to be able to reduce and stay out of the lake, maybe the community will go for it. But the option wasn't there. Another thing that I thought wasn't provided to anybody was a lot of people spoke about the stormwater drainage area, except me. But anyway, not one time did the applicant attorney say anything about they're going to pipe it to the other lake, or here's how we're going to handle this, or even really did he even say a word about it, I don't remember. So it didn't put anybody to rest that they were taking care of the stormwater. Just like, we have the right to fill the lake, and that's it. And telling the Planning Commission they didn't have a right to make this decision because of the filling of the lake. So I was sitting right next to the attorney, and I said, don't you have a big pipe you're going to lay down from Great Neck to the secondary lake there? And he goes, he said that wasn't his job.
Well, my thought wasn't so much about what might happen with the developer and make the plan go as it is, but I heard Lee talk about the community and the open space in addition to just the water thing, the space itself, is how, if in fact one of the issues, which is only in the paper, one is why I mentioned it, was in the paper about, you know, that there was issues about finance, about relative to that motivated the, this transaction, is how does the, if it is the maintenance and all the obligations that go with the pond and all that maintenance, whatever they're going to do, and that gets back to your point, is what's the solution that allows the status quo to be maintained? And it goes back to, ultimately, if you have an issue, then how do you solve that issue? Because once you set a precedent, if they would have set the precedent for doing that lot, you've already set the precedent for releasing another building where the church is today, so now it's even more houses and no open space. So that's my only point, is looking at what was that original, I'll call it community compact. It wasn't just getting the open space. The church itself is a community asset for meeting space for groups. It's more than just the religious Sunday or the Wednesday night. There's other things that churches support, and that's a community asset. And when governments rezone or put conditional use permits, they know their community benefit, an intangible asset, right? Well, that, if you take that away, that communities relied upon that when they built their home or bought their home. So how do you maintain that social compact but make it economically sustainable? I think that's what I was kind of hearing, that no one really wants to see the status quo changed. I'm sure the church would prefer not to change it either. So have of all the partners find a way that everyone can, maybe not the developer, but that's not critical. In fact, that's not even important, to tell you the truth. But how does the community get a win?
I would like to say that the city was providing a water filtration system back in 2019. It was going to go into that at the head of the lake. That's in question, and that's a hydrodynamic separator, and it was pulled because of this application.
So those, when you say the head, is that before the water goes to discharge the lint haven, or the water that's coming into the pond to go to the lint haven?
Coming into the pond. So if
okay,
you ride
good.
Off
I just
want to
know
bridge,
which. Okay, I didn't know it.
Yes, because we've the downstream owners have, lakefront owners have suffered with a poor quality of water and flow, you know, for decades really, as the city grew. So you've got the development of neighborhoods across the street, restaurants, businesses, and that's 37 acres of drainage that goes right into that pond.
So I assume that secondary lake has had sedimentation issues and whatnot?
That's right.
That's not unique. I dealt with people like, this is great, because see, this is why communities, I would encourage, because these are common problems across, it's Lake Joyce has sedimentation issues that came to the development of Church Point and other places we're now having to deal with. They're not the same capacity. So this is, and then, you know, they said they pulled that filtration, so I guess that system still exists, so I guess on whatever day in September the vote is not to do this, that's back on track?
Mm-hmm. That's kind of what the Stormwater Division had insinuated. We can't give you anything until this contract is figured out. So whether they go forward and find the property to build on, then they'll figure it all out. But we were told we were getting a system. It was federally funded, and because it's a part of the MS4 receiving waters. And first we had the Virginia Beach shooting, so the engineer that was involved in that lost her life. That was Terry Gallagher, and so the neighborhood just stepped back because nobody wants to push, you know, our complaints at a time like that. And then by the time we started to gear up again, that's when the developer got involved in this.
For those listening, when you hear the term NS4 permit, this goes back to the original consent decree of this, I forget how many states, I think it's seven states, maybe it's five, but I think it's seven states with the EPA to improve the Chesapeake Bay, so every state got an allocation or a target of reducing suspended solids and also phosphates and other kind of chemicals that would be discharged. So every community had this goal of, so that's why you saw stormwater retention ponds, dry ponds, street sweeping, everything trying to capture and reduce suspended solids. And of course every year they increased it, not every year, but every so often they increase and renegotiate further reductions. So this filtration system is one more way of reducing and capturing those suspended solids and whatnot, so they wouldn't be entering into clean up our waterways. So when you hear MS4 permit, that's it, goes to a federal consent decree, and a number of agencies have responsibility for the enforcement and compliance with that consent decree. So just for the audience's background, there's a lot of regulatory helpers. Anything, Chris, you'd like to add?
No, Wendy, you got to talk about how do you make this, something like this happen, duplicate this and other. You need to find someone like Wendy to help spearhead and organize everything, because the communication, whether by a text or email or whatnot, was really what tied us all together and got us on the same page. But one thing I did think that actually Wendy pointed out was that on the other side of the street with Great Neck, how this could possibly find a win-win solution. There are, I'm not sure the size, but there's a buffer of city-owned lots on Great Neck Manor that provide a buffer between that neighborhood and Great Neck Road. And something like that could possibly be duplicated on this same spot on our side of the street that would also help the church achieve their, resolve their issues as well. And I still think that the recognition, and one reason during the presentation today to the applicant, it was never referred to as stormwater. It was always just a pond. And I believe even on the data sheet or the site plan, it just talks about potential flooding area. It doesn't even mention the pond or anything that's there. I think we just need to realize this is an asset part of our stormwater management, and just need to figure out a way to own it and move forward with that and relieve the church of the burden of trying to maintain that.
Well, you know, we are doing the comprehensive plan being updated, and I strongly encourage you, based upon your experience here, to make sure that that kind of comment that Chris just made, that I'm sure that isn't highlighted and accounted for in the comp plan, that these places make sure that when they are reviewed, that those things are taken into consideration. And I would feedback those as a written comment back both to Chris and Councilman Taylor, and also to the planning director, that these are things that you thought, you know, from your perspective, that were not adequately being characterized. I think that, you know, without assigning any fault, but that the comprehensive plan needs to take, you know, that's the thing I couldn't ask before I left. You know, that was the one part of the resolution that the council would not approve, was that the comp plan would say that developments could not have a net adverse impact on our stormwater management system. Mm-hmm. To this day, that has not happened.
Right.
But it's obvious. Why would you spend $500 million and all this
right.
stuff and then let you buy?
Yeah.
But my point is, your point is, they just have to be reminded that we're paying attention, because there should be lessons learned from this. And you aren't the only community that's facing this issue and will face this issue going forward as infill development.
I think a comprehensive plan without identifying and accepting or acknowledging this thing, either saying it is part of our solution or it's not, and then make a decision and move forward from there. But to deny its existence is just anyway.
Mm-hmm. Well, Robert, mm-hmm. I see you busy over on your phone there. Do we have any questions from our audience, or have we so
No, for some reason it appears as though a lot of people can't hear, and I'm trying to figure that out, because I can hear. So, and I guess that's the only thing. It's, yeah. Yeah. So, if I could just remind everybody to stay close, and when you're not talking, because congestion, it picks up everything. I mean, when you're breathing.
That's me.
That's right.
Well, let me see if they can hear me, because I have a loud voice. Besides all of the issues with stormwater, which again, I'm not an expert, but I've been in and out of this neighborhood for 30 years, being my family lived there. And with all the growth that's happened, the traffic is a lot different now than it was 25 years ago on Great Neck Road, particularly since Cox High School was built. And my mother, who lived there for all those years, drove, left Great Neck States and went up the street to Laurel Cove to turn around. Because she didn't like the U-turn on Great Neck, and she didn't want to go to a traffic light and U-turn, and there's some really dangerous places in Great Neck Square to turn a car into. You see accidents there all the time. So this community really could use a stoplight right there. And with putting another little road right there and 12 houses, you know, you've got Great Neck Manor directly across the street, you've got Millwood, and you've got people turning on Millwood, turning on to Great Neck Manor from both directions. It's really a nightmare to come in and out of there. And I agree with going south before you go north there.
Like I said before, that the challenges of all this infill development, or pressures for infill development, and at higher densities, is needs a lot of resistance. There's places where it, while it may not be the best, it still makes the most sense. Along with G Beach Boulevard, let's be honest, that's a place that maybe it's going to cause congestion, but if you're going to have that as a vehicle to do certain things, that's the place. But it wasn't the place for Windsong Apartments on the end of Pleasure House Road. But no one on the council cared, or the majority didn't care about two-lane road, didn't care about the increase of setting a precedent. So there's a lot of influences that are out there that the profits go one place, but the impact goes directly in the community. But like I said before, that's why I was asking about insights from people, because also that when we, you know, there was another development that we, for a reason, nothing to do with the development, but the fact that it took 9 votes to close the public street. We didn't get Marlin Bay development, but that's by accident and not by, but the community is facing challenges. We only have so much money to pay for everything, and we only want to pay so much for everything, right?
Right. Well, so, I live in Ocean Park, so I know.
So I probably, we aren't going to see, no one wants to see Shore Drive be 6 lanes to relieve traffic. I think that's pretty certain, right? And probably no one wants us to see North Great Neck Road be 8 lane like the Boulevard to relieve traffic. So we're trading off somewhat, except some level of longer transit to maintain the quality of our life once we get home. So I think those are compromises we all make. But traveling around the country, believe me, we've made them much better than some other communities have. None of us want to be Northern Virginia, but we don't want to become that either. And so I think we'll just have to manage those. But I think the insights that you provided about how it's important to start early, be able to put up pictures to the problem and pictures to the assets, and being constructive in your comments and engaging the people to see what the community as a whole and what the obligations are, and are the paths to success. They don't always end up being successful. That's going to be a given. But I think that's what I think you've demonstrated, and I think you got Councilman Taylor early involved on your issue. To his credit, even though he doesn't like to take sides till he has to, but he gives thoughtful advice on how to get your point across. And I think you made a commission that you did that, and you should give yourself a congratulations for being a great community organizer. You should get your community organizer pin there, Wendy.
I just have to say, I don't want to take too much credit, because this is everybody in the communities. When everybody came to the Planning Commission today with a passion that was their own, we didn't coordinate what we were going to say. Everybody just spoke from the heart about what really concerned them. You know, we might have strategized a little bit to make sure certain things were discussed that we thought might be wins. But I did feel like I was really, really impressed with this Planning Commission, knowing that they met this morning at 9 o'clock and that until 12, until we got in there, and then they listened to us, and they listened very intently. And I thought that they were very genuine in their comments, and they all felt like they understood. We don't want to destroy this beautiful, especially the ones that went out to visit it. And I might add that they don't get paid for the work that they do. So they're volunteers technically, which all of us were too. We all took off work to show up for the benefit of our community. But they did take the time and they read the letters, I felt, and they did the best that they could in making the decision that, like you said, would stand up to the legal questions.
I mean, I'd just like to dovetail on that. I think some of them were truly torn with the clear decision of just releasing that conditional use permit that we were talking about earlier, very black and white decision, with the impacts that our presentations made to them. And I think that a lot of them were torn and they had to go with their gut, and that's what they did, and they voted the way they did because of it. And I thought that was admirable that they, I think, effective that we were able to make that point, but that they were able to stop and say, hey, wait a second, let's factor this in and make the decision. So that was very impressive.
Another thing I want to add about what was impressive today was, and over the course of this, was the children. We had children who really showed up. Their grandparents brought them out. Their parents brought them to the playground when the news media was there. This is what they normally do. It wasn't staged, but it was a way to show, you know, the viewers and the community what matters about this particular spot. Those same kids showed up today. So they learn how government operates. And I thought that they were going to learn that, you know, sometimes you give it your best shot and you don't get what you want. But today, they saw how excited we all were and how surprised we all were. And they will carry that with them through their lives when it comes time for them to stand up for something that them and their community cares about.
Well, that's a great observation. Robert, we have a question.
No, an observation from, I think, Mrs. Thorault. That there were two attorneys sitting on the Planning Commission today that voted against this.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know the significance, and I don't know who they were, but they must look at it from some legal aspect, and that's how they voted.
Well, I always think it's best, you know, unless proven otherwise, to give that everybody gave it their best look. And some people look at something like a jury, you know, it's, I didn't think the case was compelling, and I thought the property right of the owners was prevailed. And that's what four people thought, or something like that. Six people thought, no, the compelling case was to maintain the status quo and the property right owner who took the property with that condition on it has to live with that condition. I wouldn't read anything into the occupations of the people, how they vote, unless you have more information. It's just like, I went outside and saw the North Star. Okay, I doubt that influenced how they vote. I wouldn't assume that their occupation had anything to do with how they voted. I think this got taken on face value unless you have other information. They did their best and walk away. They say a win is a win. Why you won is less important.
I think what mattered about the legality to us was there a way for the Planning Commission to say, that there could be proffers added to this. If we're going to change the, remove the, or do the modifications, that we could add a stipulation that the BMP remains in place. So that was some of our questions about the legality that we couldn't get answered. So I thought perhaps the Planning Commission having some lawyers on might have the answer.
Well, a proffer means something that's voluntarily given by the developer or the owner of the property under no belief that unless they offered it, they weren't going to get approved. So in other words, it's basically a coerced, it wasn't a proffer. So in your case, saying, oh, we can release the religious thing if and when you, that's not a proffer. That's telling them that the only way you're going to get what you think you want, that's then a coercive, and proffers are something that people on their own without any compulsion or belief that absent that they wouldn't get a decision, then that's not a proffer, that's a coerced, you know, thing. So people are like, hey, all these little nuances are always important, because you don't want to set yourself up for having made a decision, but then how are you articulate it keeps you from being able to legally defend that decision later if you are challenged. So And if they had wanted to do all of that, they could have done that as part of their submission of their plan initially. And then that would have been a proffer on their part for the planning commission to extort or compel a proffer. It ceases to be a proffer and it's coercion, and that's not, that's frowned on. I'm not a lawyer. I just didn't Holiday Inn, but I know that's frowned upon in the court system. Any other observations there, Robert?
No. I think I may have solved the sound problem. I'm waiting to hear from folks. Sorry about that.
Well, we can always recap a little bit for the people there that we didn't, if that was an issue, we probably should have did a little sound test earlier. But like I said, big issues is comp plan. Be sure you get an input in. They're taking those inputs now. You want to get that feature recognized as something that's part of the comp plan for things we preserve. And I think you might want to share. I think I'll do your own little, I always did this when I was working for him, but maybe your own little hot wash up afterwards, you know, the good, bad, the ugly, but lessons learned. And one of the things that you, and I know that Councilman Tully would really appreciate those kind of thought process about things that you learned that you thought would, if the staff was attuned to those things, because that, you know, that assessment they do, because it's the, all expression, you know, first line of the bar, but but it's the first impression sometimes the planning commission members are getting. And so then they start, that kind of sets the highway parameters that they start looking at things, and you're trying to get that vision expanded. It's a little harder because they think that the staff has kind of laid out the framework. And so you want to make sure the framework really is broad enough that your thought processes fit in, versus trying to get people to recognize the shortfall of the thought process and then get your thought in. So you have to do two steps versus one. I think other communities could benefit from that.
I did want to say that we are reaching out to the church and the community as a whole and anybody who's interested in this, and we want to get together on Saturday at 11 o'clock and just have, you know, some time together. You know, maybe we can brainstorm a little bit on how we can overcome everyone's, you know, issues and develop a plan for something that might be better should the builder decide that this property doesn't work out for him anymore. But we have reached out to the church.
Great.
We do want to work together for something that's mutually beneficial for, you know, nature that's there and for the people that are there.
I think what also shows, which is in Virginia Beach, there is a lot of expertise in every neighborhood. Mm-hmm. You know, people with, you know, various different, but it's construction or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. I'm a biologist, I'm, you know, whatever, I know plants, I know animals. And when they all get together and put their, like any teamwork, I'm always impressed at what comes out of the neighborhood.
Sure.
But as the issues get bigger, the neighborhoods are gonna have to think, it's not just me, but how do we, when another neighborhood has the same kind of issue, how does someone say, hey, maybe it's not the whole neighborhood, but hey, we can go and help them do stuff, because we've been that lesson learned, because really, it's the pressure is on. I mean, I understand that people wanna get the highest and best yield for their property, and I mean, that's something that America is about, you know? But the same token, if you've made a contractual obligation about your property and made a commitment, then you're held to it. But in many cases, that isn't going to be the case. It's going to be the case where people, the zonings have changed, and if they want to turn a B2 office complex into a B4 apartment, much more intense, higher traffic, these are going to be issues we're going to be facing. And we're going to want to make sure that as a community, we can find an answer where everybody can win, because we're not going to just, there are going to be cases where the answer needs to be yes for the change, but do it in the most constructive way possible. If I could, Robert, do you say we had a question or an
Oh, 5 minutes.
Oh, 5 minutes.
Yeah, I'm just going to say something I found interesting is that we put this out and started getting people to sign a petition. very successful, still continuing to grow. But one thing I found interesting is that I had a bunch of folks I crossed paths with that knew about this outside of our neighborhood, completely divorced from Great Neck Road and whatnot, and that were very supportive because they were concerned about the same type of issue and then that might affect their neighborhood. So it was really interesting to see the crossing of concerns on this particular issue. So I thought that was interesting. And as more people found out about it, the more they were engaged in trying to. I mean, I found out that folks even gave money to the effort. And I was like, making me look bad.
Well, I want to thank Wendy, Andrew, and Chris for sharing with us what their journey, not to use much overused words today, but their advocacy to advocate for the community. And I'm glad that we could give them a forum, a chance to reach out. This will be rebroadcasted in terms of you will watch it on VB Liberty Facebook page. And also, people, if you share it on your Facebook page, it'll be able to be seen there. And also,
YouTube.
On YouTube, it'll be posted, so you'll be able to watch the broadcast. Our next Wednesday, we are going to be talking about the voting system. And it's probably an area where I probably have as much expertise as anyone. So I know there's some people that have been kind of leaving us with the impression that we have a choice about changing the system, but we really don't. I think the city attorney has told the council in December, he told us, in January he told them, and now he's told them publicly what he told them privately, but yet some still feel like, even if they spent $500,000 almost to find out what we think, that some are still pushing to have a ballot question. But why ask someone to vote on something whether your vote is yay or nay has no legal implementation? I don't understand it. So I plan to go through and just cover the history of that lawsuit. I think I know it as well as anyone. And we may have another guest that hasn't been confirmed yet to share with us, talk about schools, but that'll be there. And then in the future, we'll be having Linda Ramirez, our city auditor, in the light of the money losing convention center and sports center and some other things. It'll be a good time to have him to come on, and he'll share with us that the city really doesn't have a methodology to know whether or not any of these things actually generate any net money to the unrestricted general fund, and that'll be fascinating as we look forward. And then we're going to talk about affordable housing again here with another person from the building community, because I think that's especially in light of current economic events just this week, with the dollar, with interest rates, with cost of materials. I don't think housing is affordable for anyone. So I just think we have to deal with the reality of that too. So that's where we are. And
John, you may want to mention Atlantic Park and we have three very astute business people here and the projections of when we will get something back.
Atlantic Park is due to open in 2025. I don't know. All we do know is the city cannot officially tell us in what year after it opens the first dollar of profit that will come to the unrestricted general fund to pay police, fire, and teachers. But it isn't any sooner than 7 years after it opens. So I think if you were Warren Buffett, that's probably not an investment that you would have made. But nonetheless, that's something we can talk about, Lyndon, because I think that gets back to not whether or not the city should ever partner with anyone on anything, but when is it reasonable to expect that there would be a dividend to the taxpayers whose debt capacity was being used to make it work. I think who would invest in a company that told them you wouldn't get your first return on investment until 7 years from now? You probably wouldn't be investing in that company. So those are the kind of questions, you know, I think that we should all be asking as we go forward.
Bill DeStef. Thank Bill.
Oh, we're broadcasting. I think sometimes like Bill out there. No, we're broadcasting from Senator Bill DeStef's office. And he's been so kind as to donate this space to allow us to go out and talk about community issues, because this isn't Channel 3 did a great job.
They did the
super job, but they aren't able to give you the 60 minutes that we can hear and to talk about it in more detail, because I think the more we share, as Chris mentioned, that these are common issues across the city, the better we can find harmonious solutions that bring us together rather than divide us apart. And thank you all for watching.
Thursday's Tea Party meeting.
Are they meeting this Thursday?
Yes.
And who's the speaker?
The speaker tomorrow is... I'm sorry, I apologize. Just go to the Virginia Beach Tea Party. It's at the Masonic Temple on Princess Anne Road. The meeting begins at 7 o'clock.
Yeah.
And if we can just hold on for 1 minute, we'll get that information to you. And just extend your goodbyes.
Well, I'm with the silence. But, there's lots of things to be helpful about. If you can donate food at the food pantry, there's always, they're top of my list for no one should go hungry in America. So if you have an opportunity to donate cash or food to the Southeastern Food Bank, there's not a greater effort than you could donate today that would help many a family.
You could also donate to the Black Angus.
Oh, yeah.
On Great Neck Road, right? Of course, we have to give capitalists.
The speaker this Thursday night will be John Larson, Director of Public Policy and Economic Development at Dominion Energy, and he will be updating us on the offshore wind project.
Okay, so John Larson from Dominion Energy Public Policy.
Mm-hmm. And Economic Development.
Economic Development will be briefing at the Tea Party tomorrow night from 7 to 8 on Prince Anne Road at the Masonic Lodge on the right-hand side as you approach the Courthouse Center. That'll be very interesting.
Yes.
Because that wind project has, as you look at your bill, that's about a 10-15% energy per kilowatt cost increase to be more green. Anyway, thank you all for watching.